Design thinking is an experiential, human-based, and interdisciplinary way to find new ideas and develop them into innovative products. Italy's humanistic, social, and relational milieu is a singular expression of this cognitive model and a fertile soil for creative matches of arts and industry. In this presentation, I will explore cultural heritage and design thinking as key components of Italy's way to entrepreneurship. And I will discuss the nation's frameworks of innovation in reference to design, storytelling, and opera. Now, I want to start with some examples. One of the most marveling things to me when I travel to Florence is the Uffizi Gallery. And the most jaw-dropping element to me is the external architecture of the galleries, and in particular the fact that the part under the roof is decorated. Another example are the purses of Bottega Veneta, which are decorated inside and outside. So even when people don't see, there is still a decoration, as for the under roof of the Uffizi. If you see a violin, you might recognize the S shape that is inspired by the initials of Stradivari. If you like cooking, you might see the relevance of the lines in the gnocchi, the lines that serve the purpose to retain more sauce. You might recognize here the telescope that Galileo adopted for the first time to observe the stars, and not to observe the sea, as it was most commonly used. So Galileo did not invent the telescope, but he was the first one who broke the silos, who shifted planes, pointing it no longer to the sea horizon, but rather to the stars. Similar experience is the experience that led Corradino d'Ascanio, engineer for Aeropiaggio, a company that was producing parts for airplanes, to shift the technology to create a light and sturdy body for airplanes to the creation of a light and sturdy two-wheel vehicle, what we know as Vespa. So someone who was able to apply a form of knowledge from one silos to another, shifting planes. Now, from these examples, we can understand what design thinking is. Design thinking has to do with the holistic view of the parts as harmonious, as we saw in the roof of the Uffizi Gallery or in the purses of Bottega Veneta. All the parts concur in the creation of an object. Design thinking is also about the relationship between aesthetics and functionality. So the S form in the violin is not just an aesthetic element or addition, but is also something that confers a particular sound to the instrument. Also, the lines of the gnocchi are not just for mere aesthetics, but they serve the function to retain more sauce. Lastly, design thinking is about human-based knowledge. So the instrument in the service of knowledge, not the instrument for the sake of the instrument. So the shifting planes of the telescope or the technology to create light and sturdy body from airplanes to scooters avoids the sclerotization of knowledge in one field, but applies it to different layers of the human experience. Now, given these initial considerations, I want to observe the Italian model as a STEM model, which I would reframe in different terms as Scientia, Technè, Entrepreneurship, and Marvel. Now, Scientia, in its original meaning in Latin, broadly refers to knowledge. Only after the development of the scientific method, we called science the knowledge that is acquired through a particular method. But before then, Scientia referred to a holistic approach, and it's no surprise that an intellectual like Dante conceived knowledge as unified. So scientific inquiry was part of a humanistic inquiry. They were not separated as it happened starting from the 17th century onward. And this idea of knowledge that is unified in all its parts is actually behind the development in Italy of movements that have to do with one idea that applies to many different components, so the Renaissance, the Baroque, but also later Futurism or Neorealism. Now, the word Technè is a Greek word that in its origins means both art and technique or craft. So in this sense, Technè is art and functionality, art and technology originally were part of the same Technè. Now, entrepreneurship is something that relates to inquiry, to research, to initiative and risk. And Marvel is about the power of stories and beauty. Now, Scientia and Technè refer to the intersection of arts and industry, or craft and technology, that is at the base of this YouTube channel. I dedicated many presentations to this intersection as a key model in Italian entrepreneurship. Now, in this presentation, I want to observe the two other categories that I mentioned, entrepreneurship and Marvel, which I think are really key to understanding the relationship between the Italian model and design thinking. So what kind of entrepreneurship? What kind of Marvel? Regard to entrepreneurship, I need a clarification of terms. The word for entrepreneurship or enterprise in Italian is impresa, which means both company and feat. This means that in Italian culture, there are two dimensions at play when we're dealing with business, profit, or even matter. Now, business is not just economic business, but it's also busyness. And as a way to explain this, I would like to mention a passage from a very famous poem by the 19th century poet Giacomo Leopardi, the Nocturnal Song of a Wandering Shepherd of Asia, where the poet observes the sheep and asks himself this question. If you could speak, I'd ask you, tell me why it is all animals are happy, resting at ease, while I, if I lie down, am plagued with tedium. Me, se io giaccio in riposo, il tedio assale. So business is also related to a human condition of busyness. We are because we are busy. If we don't do anything, boredom assails us in the same way as Leopardi describes. Now, when we're dealing with profit, this whole idea of impresa connotes profit or value or capital as parts of a two-dimensional experience. Profit is certainly related to economic opportunity, but also profit relates to the creation of long-lasting value. As we see in the case of the Medicis and the Rucellais, two big families in Florence of the 15th century and then 16th, that created their success around wool and a particular glue for dyeing clothes. So that was their profit, but their profit also extended to a cultural capital, a cultural profit in their own palace, but also in the creation of a capital, which is what we call the Renaissance, that goes beyond their lifetime, goes beyond economic value. In the same way, when we're dealing with matter, we have to observe it as not just it as a facade, but also as something that contains something more. So materialism is not just the calculation or the study of matter, but the understanding of matter as mater, mother in Latin, something generative. So here we see wood in the studiolo of the Duke of Urbino, Federico di Montefeltro, which becomes a decorative element, or rather a storytelling device or platform telling the power of the Duke of Urbino in the Ducal Palace. Matter is also not just stone, as we see in the prisoners of Michelangelo, but really a tension to make something alive. We see this also in the research of Cellini, whose Saliera in gold is one of the greatest pieces of Renaissance artistry. We see this in the Murano glasses or in the work of Alessandro Mazzucatelli with iron, where iron, gold, glass, or even marble are not just matter, but they are speaking voices. They are generative tools. They create a capital. Of course, the greatest example of how matter can be generative is the transformation of a piece of wood or a log by Geppetto into the lively figure of Pinocchio. Now, when we're dealing with Marvel, we are dealing with an inquisitive vision, a form of observation that implies a distance. marvel that is able to create an aura around objects, and in marvel that is able to create a heritage around objects. Now, marvel is an inquisitive and penetrating gaze. To marvel means to look close and to look on the inside. Now, in this case, we see a marveling vision of an artist and of a scientist around silk. On the one hand, we see Emilio Pucci, the fashion designer from Florence, who transforms silk into a storytelling device of color and livelihood. On the other hand, we see Fiorenzo Menetto, a biotech engineer at Tufts, who discovered in silk a protein that can act as building block to create holograms or films. So matter is not just a facade, but is something that contains an inner life to be discovered by marveling around it. The same applies to the work of Gianfranco Zaccai, the designer of Reebok Pump, who found the idea for the pumping shoes that create a space to protect the ankles in the dynamic of the stomata inside leaves, in their breathing. So marveling as a form of generation of ideas. Marvel is also a way to look at things from the outside, not just from the inside. So this is the case of Massimo Bottura, top chef in Italy, who developed the idea of traditional Italian cuisine by observing it from, in his words, a 10-kilometer distance. So the possibility to renew tradition and not observe it statically is given by the fact that one can observe it from a distance. So in his case, kind of traveling abroad and rediscovering his tradition, returning to Italy. So this is how he created one of his most famous dishes, the Five Ages of Parmigiano Reggiano. Now, marvel is also rediscovering a heritage. This is the case of Gio Ponti, father of Italian design, who worked for the historic ceramic company Risorginori in the 1920s, who rediscovered in this tradition what he called the occult or hidden forces that once moved it. So to marvel is to observe tradition not statically, but to see in tradition what moved it. To marvel is also reinventing tradition. So this is what happens with art. Every form of art, in a way, is memory reinvented. In this case, we see how a movie like La Dolce Vita by Fellini is reinterpreted in recent times by Sorrentino in the movie The Great Beauty. Both movies, The Great Beauty and La Dolce Vita, owe their originality to the reinvention of a very famous novel of the late 19th century by D'Annunzio. It's called Pleasure, Il Piacere, a novel that is set in Rome and basically describes the life of pleasure of a Count Andrea Sperelli, which is then reinvented in the movies. And this novel, in turn, is inspired by a 17th century part of Adonis, which is called the Garden of Pleasure. So marvel is a form of reinvention of tradition. Marvel is also rediscovering the roots of imagination. So the link to a territory which allows the projection of a story over the century. So we see here the case of Alfa Romeo, whose symbol, the biscione, the serpent, is the symbol of the Visconti family of Milan, as we see also in the flag of the city. Nicola Romeo is an engineer from Naples who rescued the company and made it successful. Now, the link to a territory is also a key element of marvel for Emenegildo Zegna, who created in the 1930s a reforestation project to connect the life of his factory to the marveling life of nature around it. So this, after 90 years, has been renamed as Oasi Zegna. And lastly, the link to the territory as a form of marveling and projection into the future is the key asset for Brunello Cucinelli, who built in Solomeo, the headquarters of his company, a city that is based on Renaissance models and that aims to create capital not just for the present, but also, in his words, for the next 300 years. Now, to marvel is also to create an aura around objects. And this is really the key to create their value, myth-making. This is the secret of a company like Carlo Riva that produced the yachts of the Dolce Vita in the 1950s and 1960s, getting celebrities involved with his product, Sophia Loren or Brigitte Bardot, or collaborating with Lamborghini to create a Carlo Riva yacht with Lamborghini engines, to use celebrities to create a myth around their products. This is also the case of Ferrari, where the marvel of the products relate to its storytelling. So the pranking horse is actually related to the symbol of his youth idol, Francesco Baracca, who was a World War I ace of airplane fights. Once he died, Ferrari adopted the pranking horse as his own symbol and made it the center of his epic. Now, the creation of a space around the object, or what we call marvel, is very well exemplified in the work of Ennio Morricone, the score writer for the most famous movies by Sergio Leone, the Western, or Spaghetti Western, as they were called. So the creation of music as a mental space. Morricone was the first to conceive soundtracks not as accompaniments of a narrative in a movie, but really as the story. So in the movies, music creates a mental space, creates a narrative. It's invisible, but it creates the narrative around the objects, around the actors. What I described as aura is a secret, hidden storytelling tune that makes these objects unforgettable. Now, from these observations, it appears that the humanistic element is a key reference in Italian culture and an added value in defining its success. Now, to compare the Italian model with the Anglo-Saxon model allows us to understand even more what I mean. This is a brief explanation of how the Italian approach to design and innovation differs from the Anglo-Saxon approach to it. I already discussed this in a presentation which I dedicated to Italian design, the Italian way, what makes Italian design unique, and I won't dwell on it too much. But what I want to focus my attention on is really the difference between the Italian versus the American narrative frameworks on originality and how the Italian method or the American method to finding new ideas differ. So how do we define an Italian way to innovation versus an American way to it? And what is the Italian, what is the American approach to the finding of new ideas? I like to explore four narrative paradigms. The first relates to the opposition or the opposite views between past and future. Now, the American approach model to innovation relates to the West. You see Buffalo Bill here, to the frontier, to the creation of the future. So innovation is a forward-looking attitude that goes west to an uncharted territory. The Italian model relates to the idea that the artist or the stylist or the designer is looking backwards to the past to find in it the driving force to reinvent it and to elaborate from it a grounded innovation or a force that allows to propel us forward. In this case, the symbol of innovation is the snail, which I also used in Italian Innovators as a reference. Snails were used in Baroque still lives as symbols of the variety of being, because their shells had many shapes and colors. This idea implies that innovation is going backwards to find something that propels us forward and that can create rooted innovation and not just the quest for the new for the sake of the new. The second model relates to the difference between the incremental way to innovation, which relates to different silos that are compartmentalizing the different aspects of a product, moving it forward by incremental modifications. This model is opposed to the model of the orchestra, of the opera, if we want. Opera means works in Latin. So the concinitas, so the singing together of different works and languages. So in opera, the works of acting, of playing, of singing, of the costumes, of the librettist. So many works that sing together at the same time without being necessarily compartmentalized. The model for this, of course, is Toscanini, the great orchestra conductor, who was the first to transport the experience of theater, of unity, of singing together from the theater to the radio and to the TV. He was the first one who had live performances. So the idea of organic continuity. Now we see this idea also in a product like Campari, who transformed the drink as a platform where cinema, photography, design, poster illustration, architecture can relate. So the product is conceived organically as the point of emanation of many different languages. We also see this in the case of Olivetti, who produced typewriters. He's the pioneer of computing and typewriting in Italy, who again related the production to architecture, design, but also politics and the creation of a particular social utopia. It was called comunità, community, which expanded the idea of the product itself onto a social reality. So the product is not just it, but it becomes an emanation of meanings. Now, the third paradigm or narrative framework that I want to explore is the one that relates to the opposition between technological execution versus incanto. So we relate in the American context innovation to technological developments. In the Italian context, this narrative changes a little bit. So innovation relates to the creation of an enchantment around objects or a story. So the creation of the dome of Brunelleschi as a marvelous architectural feat, but also as a story that attracts our attention. And also you see the facade of Santa Maria Novella by Leon Battista Alberti, who transforms the facade into a site of decoration and storytelling or application of geometry to aesthetics. This idea of transforming technology into an aesthetic tool is at the base of the success of Ducati, whose designer, engineer Fabio Taglioni, created an L-shaped engine that he wanted to be beautiful, not just for the sake of beauty, but really to enhance performativity. So the aesthetics that enhances performance. This is also the case for furniture. I'm showing you some examples from Carlo Bugatti, who transforms furniture from the site of functionality into a site where we inhabit the house as a space of storytelling of beauty. Now, this idea also applies to the creation of perfumes. This is the case of Maria Candida Gentile, who basically challenged the perfume industry and the chemical mass production of perfumes by observing or retrieving a traditional form of extraction of olfactory notes and the production of natural perfumes that are conceived as centers of aesthetic reflection. So every perfume is accompanied by literary reflections. Every perfume, in a way, expands from the product to the creation of an environment, what we call aura or marvel. This is also the case of a steel company like Cimolai, who transformed steel from a building material into a language of beauty. We see it in the vessel in Hudson Yards in New York, in railway stations and stadiums that are transformed into not just engineering architectural structures, but into works of art. The fourth paradigm I want to observe relates to the contrast between short-term management versus long-term entrepreneurship. In the Anglo-Saxon model, it's very common to conceive management as a short-term commitment that leads to another commitment or maybe other advancements. In the Italian model, instead, entrepreneurship relates to a long-term story. We see this in the case of Bottega Veneta, where the idea of production relates to the construction of schools related to the art of production. So the school of leather masters of Bottega Veneta is what allows the company to prolong itself over time, to move beyond the present and think of the next 20, 30 years to create its own base. Now, the Italian model also relates to the family model, which is a long-term entrepreneurial model. Of course, the family model has become part of a Hollywood motif where, based on the archetype of the Godfather, family ownerships are represented as sites of feuds and rivalries and petty behaviors. We see this, for example, in the House of Gucci. As we see in the case of Ermenegildo Zegna, we have to note that the family model is a model that encourages continuity across generations, that encourages loyalty in the workers, that trust the leadership because of its longevity. This is a model that we see also in the continuity of generations. This is the case of Laura Biagiotti, the fashion house house that reached the third generation of old women. So Lavinia Belgiotti now is the third generation head of the company. We also see this in the most blatant case of long-term entrepreneurship, which is the company Marinelli in Molise, which is the oldest running company in the world. It was established in the 14th century and it's still operating after almost 800 years. So these models are part of the long breath of entrepreneurship. The humanities, the arts, play a big role in the evolution of this model. Now imagine Campari without the red, the logo, or the soda. Or imagine the Lamborghini Countach without its story. The Lamborghini Countach was created in 1974 by a Piedmontese engineer that loved it so much they called it contagion. And the word for it in Piedmontese dialect is the word Countach. So imagine these products without their stories, how much deprived they would be. In this sense, I want to develop in my conclusion a little bit of a reflection on the relationship between entrepreneurship and storytelling, or rather to describe entrepreneurship as storytelling. So design thinking is a synthesis of creative and strategic mindset. Storytelling embodies this synthesis by endowing objects with stories. And stories are part of the planning of objects. I want to show you how storytelling techniques really apply to entrepreneurship. So we see this, for example, in the search for an idea. And this is the case of Tiffany jewelry designer Elsa Peretti, who designed her famous bone cuff because once she was a little girl, she visited a Capuchin church where there were bones embedded in the walls and where she really touched them and felt them as lively objects. And so she wanted to give her gold pieces the sense of livelihood that she felt. So the search for an idea into experience. Then we see the search for depth. This is the case of Fabiola Gianotti, director of the CERN in Geneva. She was the Italian scientist who announced the discovery of the Higgs boson in 2012. And she has also a piano degree. So the search for depth in the exploration of the universe relates to the search for beauty in music and, in her case, also dance. Now we see also the power of objects, of magic objects, for example, dresses, like in costume design by Milena Canonero. Dresses become abiti. So abito in Italian means both dress and habit. So dresses that become psychologies, dresses that become costumes, costumes that become ways of living. Now, dresses are magical objects, like design objects are magical objects. We see here, for example, the archetype of Pinocchio that enters into the creation of a lively corkscrew by Alessandro Mendini, turn from an object of use into an object of stories. We also see how limit becomes a creative source. So the scarcity of cocoa in the post-war years propelled the Ferrero family, first Pietro Ferrero and then Michele Ferrero, his son, to develop a mix of cocoa and hazelnut, which was the ingredient that was more common in the Lange region where they are from. This mix is really at the base or the discovery of Nutella. We also see in story the fact that elements, when blended together, generate new works. And this is the case of Lavazza, who first experimented the blending of coffee beans to create different varieties according to his client's taste. Now, in this case, the work of Lavazza resembles the work of Toscanini, of an orchestra conductor who is able to blend different timbres of different instruments into one coherent voice. And also we see how entrepreneurship relates to the same dynamic of storytelling in the plot twists. So in the case of Ferdinando Bocconi, we see how the owner of Italy's first and largest department store, Ville d'Italie or Magazzini Bocconi, changed his path after the sudden and unexpected death of his son Luigi Bocconi in Adua in 1896 during a colonial battle that Italians lost in Ethiopia. Now the death of Luigi Bocconi stirred Ferdinando, his father, to rethink of his business and open in 1902 a university dedicated to his son Luigi. Now the university is the first commercial university in Italy, and it's now the most famous institution of Business and Economics in Italy, La Bocconi. Another plot twist is also related to Ducati that we mentioned earlier. Until the 1940s, the company was the leading producer of radio parts and cameras in Italy. Until when, in 1944, during Allied bombing of Bologna, the factory was destroyed. And that led to a plot twist. After the war, to recover from the debts and try to re-establish the factory, the company designed a little clip-on engine to be attached to bicycles, which were the only means of transportation available with all the roads that were destroyed. This clip-on engine called Cucciolo is what really introduced the idea of motorcycling as an entrepreneurial option. Now, we know that Ducati is the Ferrari of motorcycles, but that story starts from a plot twist, an unexpected bombing. So in this sense, I want to conclude saying that entrepreneurship is really an adventure story, and the life of a business is really like the plot of a book. And innovators are really those who are able to see the connection among things, like a writer or a novelist does, to see value in a detail and to see the vanishing point or the energy that an object is able to create around itself and develop it into a story or what we call value. Now, these are some initial reflections that I wanted to share with you, and I'm curious to hear what you think. If you like this presentation, I invite you to subscribe to this YouTube channel. If you want to follow me on social media, you can find me on Instagram or LinkedIn. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel, and don't forget to subscribe to the newsletter at www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications of new episodes and updates about my research. Thank you very much for your attention. Arrivederci e alla prossima.